As we know, most of the bugs resides inside the code, which is responsible for parsing user data. So, if you want to find a bug which is exploitable remotely, you have to dig deeper inside the network data parsing code. Recently, I asked you on Twitter if you want to see a video about this, and you said yes. So, I'm delivering. In this video, I'm trying to explain my reverse engineering approach, including reverse engineering network code, reconstructing packet data formats, and creating structures in IDA. That's why the video turned out to be a bit lengthy, so you can use chapters below the video for your convenience. So relax, grab yourself a cup of tea, and let's go! As we are interested in reverse engineering some proprietary network protocols, we need to find a proper target. And one of the ways to take a look at network attack surface of some application is to use a tool called TCP view from sysinternals. Basically, this tool shows you all TCP and UDP ports used by processes on your machine. And for our target, I'll pick this particular process. It listens on all network interfaces and uses TCP port number 20,000-2022. So now we need to obtain this process executable file. I can double click on it and I can say pass to this process executable. And now I'm going to copy it and load it into IDA Pro. So now I've loaded my binary into IDA Pro. And of course you can use any other tool of your liking because the principles are the same. We can start our reverse engineering from main function, but by doing so, we'll need to reverse engineer a lot of code, which relates to initialization and some other stuff like this. And basically, it has nothing to do with our network protocol. So we're gonna try and locate the very place where parsing of network packets goes on. To do this, we are gonna go to import tab, and basically this tab contains all library functions our target binary is using. To work with network in Windows, you need to use a recv function, and basically there is no way around it. So we are gonna try and go take a look at where and how our binary uses this function. So now we are in imports section of the binary where data about our recv function resides, and by pressing Ctrl X I can open a window with so-called cross references. Basically it's a list of places which somehow refer to this location in binary. As we can see, we have only one xref, and let's go here. So we see that our import is used by function recv, and by pressing Ctrl X again, we can see that this function itself is used in two functions in our binary. Actually, let me correct myself. It is used in one function, but in two places, which is also common. So let's go here. And from now on, I'm gonna use hexrace decompiler just to save us some time. So, function recv takes four arguments. The first one is a socket. Here we can see that it uses socket from a field in presumably some structure pointer A1. The second argument is a buffer where received data is going to be stored. The third argument is length of data we want to receive, or maybe I should say maximum length of data we want to receive. And the fourth argument is flags. And at the beginning of the function, we can see that our length is set to 4. So this code wants to receive 4 bytes. And function receive returns an integer value. If this value is set to -1, it indicates that some error has happened, and otherwise this value is equals to number of bytes which has been received by network. So I can rename a variable v6 to a name which will make more sense. For example, number of bytes received. And we can see that directly after calling function receive, our binary checks for an error, and if error happened or if 0 bytes has been received, it immediately returns. Otherwise, it increments pointer to our buffer, which stores received data by number of bytes received. Then it checks whether or not it received more data than it wanted to, and after that it decrements variable len by number of bytes received. So let's stop here and take a minute to think about what a programmer intended to do by writing this code. It seems that he wanted to receive strictly 4 bytes, no more and no less. So for example, if at first iteration of this loop only 1 byte has been received, so number of bytes received equals 1, then buffer is incremented by 1 and length is decremented by 1. So in the next iteration of the loop, received is going to be called with length equals 3. And if this function happens to receive 3 bytes, then length is going to be decremented by 3 and is going to be 0, and our loop will exit. On line 21, we can see that variable src is used, but we can notice that earlier on line 10, our buffer was set to equal src, and we know that the buffer and src are both pointers, so basically it means that it kind of the same variable. So we can rename src to something like buff2. Now line 21 makes more sense. It copies contents of our buffer to variable called matlong, and on the next line it converts the order of bytes in variable matlong from network order to host order, and the result of this conversion is again stored is in variable len, so this variable is reused. Then some function is called on this variable. For now we just want to leave it here and finish examining our first function. And this loop looks really similar to the loop we examined earlier. Basically, those are the same loops, except of line 32. It seems that at offset 8 in structure A1, something like counter of all bytes received is stored. But what is interesting about this loop is that it uses len variable, the same length which was received earlier. So basically, the first loop received a header of a packet which consisted of 4 bytes, and those 4 bytes indicate length of following data in the packet. And all this data is collected in the second loop. And we got to the midpoint of the video. As you know, I'm striving to provide you new learning opportunities and monetize my channel. While the course is on its way, I thought that I can share my experience with you by providing you consultations about reverse engineering, cybersecurity, web security, and maybe even give some advice about career. More info about them in the link in the description. So now I can rename this function to something like receive packet. And to save us some time, I can say that this function allocates heap buffer according to expected length of a packet. So I can rename it to something like allocate buff for packet. So now we know how presumably 1 packet of data is received. Let's take a look at how the binary uses our function receive packet. To do this, I once again gonna open up a list of cross-references. And we can see two cross-references. The first one, I don't know about it, maybe it's some piece of dead code, because it's it resides not inside of a function. And I know from my experiences that IDA auto-analysis was pretty good on this binary, so I'll skip this one and I'll go to the second cross-reference. So here we can see that our function receive packet takes an argument which was auto-renamed by IDA to pmem, and we want to take a look at how pmem is initialized. So we are gonna enter the first function which uses pmem variable. We can start from renaming its arguments, so I know that a1 is pmem, and yes, the second argument, it seems like it's a socket for the network connection. So I can rename it to sock. And here we can see that this function allocates 24 bytes with the help of global alloc. Then it tries to lock this allocated buffer and assigns this pointer to pmem. So now it seems clear that the size of pmem is 24 bytes in hex. And here we can see a lot of pointer arithmetics going on. And if we look at the next function, we can see pointer arithmetics here as well. And it's not really the most convenient method to examine a piece of code. So we are gonna turn pmem into C-style structure. By pressing Shift and F9, we can open up structure tab, and by pressing insert we can create new structure. So for now let's go with the default name struct1, and let me add the first member of this structure, which has size of double word. And then I can do a little trick and make an array of these fields, and we can see that now the total size of our structure is exactly 24 in hex. So let's go back to our code and let's retype pmem variable. We know that previous function passed not pmem itself but pointer to pmem. So I think that here pmem is actually will be a double pointer to our struct1. So now we can see why it's actually really helpful to create structure instead of ugly pointer arithmetics. We can clearly see all the fields of our structure being assigned. For now, I don't really know anything about these fields, but I can rename field 14 to sock because it's assigned a network socket. So let's rename this function to something like struct1 constructor. And let's take a look at this function. Let's retype a1 to pointer to struct1. We can do this by doing so. And now we can clearly see all the fields of our structure being used. So what's going on here is not directly related to network protocol parsing, so let's use the power of video editing to speed up the process of renaming fields in our structure. So after all this work was done, let's convert pmem to pointer to struct1 and go inside a receive packet function and do exactly the same thing. And here we can see that we were absolutely right by saying that this field is socket, because we can see that it corresponds perfectly with what's going on here. And we can see that on line 25, field buffer of size 1000 is used as our tracker buffer to store packet data. As you have probably guessed, I renamed this field earlier, and it indeed stores a pointer to buffer of size 1000. And also, we can rename field 8 to something like total bytes received. So let's go back and let's take a look at this whole function. So in the beginning, it sets some socket options, then it constructs our struct 1, does some thread safe incrementing of some global value, then sets field 18 to 0, and tries to do some work in a loop. So I think that I can rename V5 to something like stop, so it will make more sense. So we know that field 18 was set to 0 array, so let's not think about what's going on here, and let's look at the code a little bit further. We can see that this function takes pmem, so let's go here, let's convert a1 to pointer to structure, and we know that field c was earlier set to 0, and it certainly will be less than total bytes received, so this condition will be satisfied. And here the function takes some value from our packet and stores it to the value pointed by a2, and then field c is incremented. So let's again take a minute to think about logical meaning of this function. We know that it takes the first byte of the packet and stores it inside of the value pointed by the second argument. So it seems like field C is some kind of a pointer inside the packet itself. And this function might not be used only here, but it might be used more generally. So to sum up, this function retrieves a parameter of length 1 from our packet. So let's rename it. Something like get 1 byte from packet. And let's rename field C to pointer inside packet. Okay, so now it's making more sense. And now we can rename V11 to something like first byte. And here we can see how the first byte sent via network by user is used.
So far, we got to the most interesting part of the code, a switch which decides what function to execute based on the first byte of the packet. This is actually what we are after. This video is already so long and it took forever to make it, so I'll do the most irresponsible thing possible and leave you on this cliffhanger. If you don't want to miss the second part of this video, consider subscribing and maybe even hitting this bell button. Also, I have a question for you. I want to better connect with you guys, so I want to create a place where we can chat, discuss our ideas, and maybe even stream. What do you think? Which platform is more convenient? Let me know under the top comment. Don't forget to check out the link in the description, and as always, happy hacking, you guys!